There are eyes that see the future, there are eyes that see all, and there are eyes that guide the fate of humanity. Quite an impressive variety, if you ask me. Before we hop into this chat about the Dojutsu of Naruto, please do me a favor and leave a like, comment, and subscribe if you haven't already. Now, let's get into it. What's up, guys? I got the pencil here, and here we are to chat about the Dojutsu of Naruto, or the eyes, those gosh darn eyes. Now, here's the thing. I consider the Kekkei a sort of superpower in the Naruto world. And you may be like, huh? What do you mean? And to say that, I mean, Kekkei are rare. Everyone has chakra. Most people can perform chakra natures, such as fire style, water style, wind style. They usually have attributes for it, summoning jutsu. Everyone has chakra. So it's not that special. When everyone's super, no one will be, obviously. However, Kishimoto understood this and decided to create the Kekkei, which are evolutions to certain clans or certain people that no other people outside of that clan or outside of that person have access to. However, as much as I like the Kekkei, they're going to be getting their own video because there are a lot more Kekkei than there are Dojutsu, especially relevant Dojutsu. So the thing about the Dojutsu is that they are that superpower idea taken to an extreme. The eyes of the Byakugan, the Sharingan, the Rinnegan, and we'll do a little bit of talk about the Kitsuryugan. These are all eyes that are extremely powerful, are extremely locked and limited. In the case of the Rinnegan, literally can't even be obtained by one clan unless you're literally an alien. So these eyes are rare, these eyes are powerful, and these eyes are dangerous. However, not only do I like all these eyes for their powers, but the main reason I enjoy these eyes so much is because of what they stand for within the narrative themselves and what they mean for the character that possesses them. Now, in my mind, if you really want to have a good superhero story or a good superpower story in general, you want the powers to affect your characters in some sort of way. You don't want the power to just be there and it basically means nothing for the character. It's just a separate addition that never impacted their life, never changed anything about them, and has never done anything for them, other than just be a convenient power whenever they need it. That's why I think stories that work like that are alright, but they aren't the best. However, to make that story really, really good in my mind, to improve it to a different degree, is you want to make the superpower tie directly into the character, have the growth of the superpower correlate to the growth of the character, whether it be a positive growth or a negative growth. I think the eyes do that very, very well in all cases, except for maybe the Byakugan, but I think the Byakugan still works because of what the Byakugan means for other techniques. So, for Neji, an example, his power over the Byakugan is something that's affected him for his entire life. He was a prodigy with it. However, he was born into the lower caste. He simply wasn't a top-tier Hyuga member, at least not by birth. And thus, despite him having this superpower, the superpower that he was so gifted with that he managed to master the trigrams, a very difficult Hyuga technique that's completely outside of his grasp, or at least it should have been, it doesn't matter. Because due to the fact that he was born a Hyuga, but born a Hyuga in a lower caste, he wasn't given the same respect, he wasn't allowed to be taught. He had to learn by himself, and that's what made him so bitter and jaded to the idea of destiny and fate. And that's because of his superpower. That's something that he can't control, that he was born with, that affects him to this day. And I think that's great. Look at Sasuke. The entire growth of him and his Sharingan comes from the traumatic experience he had with Itachi. And every single time Sasuke's Sharingan develops, that's when Sasuke as a character develops. Whether it be his development for a lust for power, or his development from understanding change and developing and growing. The initial Sharingan activation coming from the death of his family, because the Sharingan is an ability activated by pain that's a latent gene within the Uchiha. That's a great start for Sasuke's character and for Sasuke's power. Seeing Sasuke reawaken the power, a power he had lost for a long, long time, because Naruto was in danger, his friend was in danger, and he wasn't gonna let people he cared about die again. It's a perfect time to reawaken that sign of power that is not only extremely potent, but ties directly into Sasuke's growth as a character. A person who was isolated, thus never could access the power since it came from that connection, regaining the power because of the connection he had forged once again. However, the thing is that the Sharingan is inherently a toxic power. It typically grows when Uchiha goes through great stress, great emotion, and to be fair, in the time that Sasuke was living in, where he had no family and his brother was a murderer that he needed to go kill, he couldn't have much positive emotion. So his eyes couldn't grow in the same positive light that some Uchiha's could. And the issue with that for Sasuke means that for him to get more powerful, for his superpower to grow, he needs more hatred. He needs more darkness. He needs more suffering for his character. And the way the two intertwine, the further Sasuke falls in the darkness, the further his eyes grow to allow him to peer deeper into that darkness and to gain more from it. It's so good. It's so interesting. And I love how the Mangekyo Sharingan for Sasuke comes from his realization that his entire life was a lie, that when he finally killed his brother, when he achieved his goal, he was wrong. And that didn't just grow his Sharingan's prowess. It didn't just keep him locked at the three Tomoe. It literally evolved them to an entirely different stage. And the way that the powers of the Sharingan tie symbolically into pretty much every single character who wields them, the Mangekyo Sharingan especially, it's great stuff. I love it when superpowers reel back and flow into the characters they are affected with and come back out stronger or come back out different. I love when two things are intertwined. They aren't just independent aspects. For the Rinnegan, look at Pain. All of his suffering came from those darn eyes because they were implanted in him by Madara. And due to those eyes that are meant to guide the world or destroy it, he was led into a position where he had to guide the world or destroy it. He created the Akatsuki in the memory of Yahiko, but Yahiko wouldn't have died if it wasn't for those eyes. It wasn't for Nagato being such a big threat because he had the Rinnegan. This power that Nagato wasn't even born with still affected him fundamentally as a person and led to his suffering throughout his life. And this suffering is what led to Nagato being this jaded, hurt character that believes the only way you can control people is through a constant flow of fear. It's this different sort of dark approach to a power that is literally considered divine within the verse itself. The ability to control life and death, the ability to control different aspects of the world, different parts of nature, the ability to summon these beasts, these monsters. This is all the power of the Rinnegan, but for Nagato to achieve that power, for Nagato to delve into it, he had to lose so much. He had to suffer so much because the superpower came with a cost. It wasn't something free. And that's what I love so much about Naruto for the most part when it comes to these eyes. These eyes come with amazing abilities. The Byakugan, 360 degree vision with one blind spot that allows you to see chakra networks and allows you to shut them down by attacking them directly. Amazing power. The Sharingan, the ability to copy your opponent, read into their future, the ability to steal their techniques by simply observing them once, enhancing all your physical prowess, all of that, amazing. The Rinnegan, giving you powers over creation and destruction itself, amazing. However, every single character that is afflicted with one of these, and note how I use the word afflicted, because while these are gifts, they come with such heavy cost, because every character who is afflicted has gone through a form of suffering. The superpower is never just part of them that happened, they happened to have by birth, and they were just given, and then they just got away with it. There was nothing, no complexities, no freedom from it, because these powers always tie into something of the character, whether it be the Sharingan progressing only through the suffering of certain characters, whether it be Itachi, Madara, or Sasuke, whether it be the Rinnegan causing suffering because of the great power it holds in the case of Nagato, or how long it even took Madara to get the Rinnegan in his terms of life because he literally had to wait until he was on the verge of death and had to transfer them somewhere else. Not in terms of how the Byakugan, while being a natural inborn power that every single Hyuga has, comes with different levels to it, different amounts of suffering based on where you're born and your ability and mentality as a person. I love it. All these different factors come together and make it so that the superpower has cost towards the character, and I think that's great. However, I won't say the use of Dojutsu in Naruto is perfect, because the thing that happens is they get resorted to just power-ups to a point. Like, there are multiple Byakugan users that don't really, well, not multiple, really there's just Ao from the war. And I see Ao and I'm like, okay, so he suffered to get it. Like, he stole it from a Hyuga. But we don't see how that affects Ao as a character, because Nagato technically wasn't born with a Rinnegan, but it affected him so much because the superpower came with that cost. But Ao is a side character, so whatever, we'll give him a pass. But look at Danzo. Danzo didn't really suffer much for a Sharingan. He just stole the thing. And while that's more suffering for other characters like Sasuke and Itachi and Obito, people who actually had to grow up and live with the burden of the Uchiha name and the Sharingan that came with it, and Danzo just gets the free pass, it sort of devalues the Dojutsu in and of itself. And not gonna lie, as cool as the Rinne Sharingan is, and as cool as Hagoromo is and all that, while we understand that Kaguya and Hagoromo went through their own variations of suffering. It's not as deep, it's not as personal, it's not as interconnected and well fleshed out as the suffering of other characters with the Rinnegan. So it makes you wonder, like, was it, I mean, I suppose it was necessary to give it to them if you're going to introduce them. And my main issue is, as much as I like Sasuke's growth as a character and his fall to darkness, while I do have problems with it, I believe the Rinnegan at the end, just that gift he got from Hagoromo, sort of devalues the constant growth that Sasuke had with it. Because to be fair, as far as I can tell, Sasuke's acquiring of the Rinnegan didn't necessarily change him fundamentally as a character. It didn't signify a massive character change within Sasuke. Unless you want to say that him wanting to commit murder on all the Hokage or all the Kage and take over the world is the change that was caused by the Rinnegan. So maybe there's that, but I feel like after a point, the Rinnegan and the eyes, the Dojutsu in general, just stop being character tools and character functions, superpowers with costs, and more so just superpowers. Like, oh, we need to power a character up. Quick, slap this eye in their socket, because you can just do that in Naruto. I think that's my only issue. If the eyes had stayed what they were from Rip, this power that came with such great abilities, such amazing abilities, but came with a cost, I think I would love them. I think I'd darn near call it a flawless system, because it works to not only spice up the actual battles, because these are unique superpowers that not everybody has, and they lead to different functions, different abilities, and how they can be used, but also as great character tools, a great way to track a character's growth by allowing their eyes and their powers to evolve one way or another. But obviously, the end of Naruto has some problems. I'm definitely going to talk about that in the future. However, I still think the Dojutsu as a whole is a fantastic system. And also, real quick on the Ketsuryugan and the Shinoke, the main thing I like about them is that they are natural prey to the Uchiha, because basically the Ketsuryugan is a lesser Sharingan, at least as far as I can interpret it. Sure, you can control iron-rich blood and you can make people explode, but considering their genjutsu appears to be weaker than Uchiha genjutsu, and they were literally hunted and killed by the Uchiha because they were considered dangerous, I just find that cool. That's just more extra lore, and I also like the cost that comes with it. Yeah, you gain these amazing abilities over genjutsu and the ability to control blood. However, you're instantly considered a massive threat because of those dangerous-looking frog eyes that take people over and blow them up. So you're going to be hunted down. So while it's a very, very late-game ability that Kishimoto comes up with, it still works out in the sense that it is important enough to tie into the characters of the people afflicted by it. So I think it's still very good. And I have no real comment on the Jogan. I suppose it comes with suffering, you know, Momoshiki infesting Boruto, so there's a cost. And in terms of the Tensegan, I guess it comes with a cost, but I don't know, it's movie, Toneri, I don't have much to say about the Tensegan other than I wish it was like the Rinnegan, and there was a middle stage for the Byakugan, so we could get more Byakugan growth, but that's neither here nor there. And I suppose that's the only other way I would improve the system. Keep it so that the growth for the Byakugan matches the Sharingan, because giving the Sharingan all these stages just in its base state and giving the Byakugan either just the on and off mode, it kind of sucks, I'm not gonna lie, because the Byakugan seemed to be this rival to the Sharingan in some way, shape, or form. However, it lost itself so quickly because it just wasn't allowed to grow. But that's about it. I love Naruto Dojutsu, but tell me what you guys think about Naruto Dojutsu. Do you think they're good? Do you think they're bad? Is there any way that you would improve them? Is there any way that you think they need to be nerfed? Because I think they could use some nerfs. They are pretty strong. You need to be a Jinchuriki to fight them, or you need to be Naruto, which is a Jinchuriki. So that's the thing. Maybe they need nerfs. Tell me what you guys think in the comment section down below. Thank you guys so much for watching. Please remember to like, share, comment, and subscribe. And I hope you guys have a wonderful day. This is That Got the Pencil, writing off.